adults and children who live in communities who are on Title 19 and who have a mental health diagnosis, the state has really determined with their huge investment in local IHHs that local support is the best support for these families. Calling an 800 number and getting someone in Des Moines when you live in Cedar Rapids and you're having a mental health crisis is not how you get your communities to function the best way. So having localized support and partnering with agencies is really the best way that communities can get their arms wrapped around their most vulnerable citizens.
So hello, welcome back to You Need a Counselor podcast. My name is Julie Johnson. I am the president and founder of Heart and Solutions here in Iowa. So if you are located anywhere close to our 7 office locations and you are looking for mental health counseling or in-home behavioral health intervention counseling, let us know. We're also doing telehealth right now still, and we're doing online counseling as well. So reach out to us if you listen to this episode and you decide that you need a counselor.
I'm Krista. I am the vice president at Heart and Solutions in charge of our behavioral health program. So we go in home, in school, telehealth, in the office as well, and work with kids ages 4 to 18 on different behavioral health goals that they set. And this is our podcast, You Need a Counselor. So we are designed for people curious about counseling, but have barriers keeping them from experiencing the benefits of counseling. Our mission is to share stories about counseling, good, bad, and indifferent, and spread the message that everyone can benefit from mental health and behavioral health counseling services.
Yeah, so we post on Sunday nights at 5 o'clock Central. So save up your laundry, batch up your putting away laundry task. I feel like putting away the laundry is the worst part of doing laundry, right? Like, I don't mind throwing it in the washing machine. My kid will help me take that soggy laundry and put it in the dryer, but man, putting it all away is a chore. So don't do that on a Monday night. Don't do that on a Thursday night. Save that up. Do that all at one time. Krista and I will be putting away our clean laundry on Sunday night. That prepares you for an entire week of clean underwear, right? So let's get batching that task up together. And you can listen to the podcast while you put away that laundry. We also, that gives you the entire week to get set up with a counselor to get connected with any of the resources that we share on this podcast, including the resource that we're going to share about today, which is Four Oaks IHH Integrated Health Home Program. So that gives you an entire week to get connected if that's a service that's going to be beneficial to you. Okay, so today we've got a very special guest with us. We've got Sue Brooks. So welcome, Sue. Thanks for being here.
Thank you for having me. I'm excited to talk to you guys today.
Awesome. Yeah, we're very excited to have you here. So Sue is the director of the Integrated Health Home. So if you're in Iowa and you hear the term IHH, you might be like, what is that? So we're going to tell you what that is today. And she runs that IHH out of Four Oaks. And so if you're in Iowa, you've heard of Four Oaks, but you might not know that they have such a great integrated health home program and all of the services that you can expect to find out there at Four Oaks with this program. So I will let Sue talk about what IHH is, but it includes all kinds of things: family peer support, registered nurse access. It includes holistic case management. So just all different kinds of services that you might not think about when you think about either Four Oaks, or that you might not think about when you think about integrated health home. And then they also help coordinate mental health waivers. So if you are in the area and interested in mental health waiver, they can really help coordinate that for kids and for adults, which is great, because I think a lot of times we think about Four Oaks, we think about kids. And so being able to serve adults as well is just fantastic. So we're very, very excited to have Sue here today. So Sue, tell us about Integrated Health Home, IHH. What is that? What is it?
Integrated Health Home is a Medicaid funded program for children and adults who have a mental health diagnosis. And We coordinate care, just like you said, Julie, in your introduction. We coordinate community-based care for children and adults to be successful at home, at school, and in the community. We partner with great agencies like your own in getting these kids set up with services. And the most important piece is that making sure they're accessible services for the family. We take into consideration, as you said, holistically, the children, what are the common barriers, transportation, money, employment, housing. If a child is on Title 19, they're already vulnerable, right? Because they're already most likely living at or below the poverty level. Same with adults. They either have a disability and they're collecting SSI, or they are living at or below poverty level. So already they're at risk for employment, housing, services, transportation, education. There's already so many barriers. What IHH does is we come alongside families and adults to help them break through these barriers by hooking them up with community resources. We do a lot of case management, a lot of coordination of care. We have a registered nurse who can help families navigate appointments, medication reconciliation. She can help gather diagnoses for us when we have children that get a slot on the child mental health waiver. She can help us get therapy notes for an adult who wants to enter habilitation services. So we also have family peer support, which is an advocate who will talk to families every month or as often as needed. And we also offer, which is very unique to Four Oaks, we offer peer support, which is specifically targeted at transitional age kids who are 17 and a half and above, who are going out into our communities with not a lot of natural supports. A lot of these children don't have family. A lot of these children have aged out of treatment. A lot of these children have aged out of foster care. They don't have any natural supports in the community. Our family peer support program helps children that are going to be 18 navigate adulthood through housing, services. Finding a primary care physician is very important. Knowing where their nearest urgent care is will help them navigate transportation, the buses. We will help them fill out their financial aid documents they need if they want to go on to college or some other secondary education. We help them get their HISET if they haven't graduated high school. So we offer a lot. Four Oaks is very diverse, as you said, Julie. When people think about Four Oaks, they think children. They think our treatment. We have PMIC and we have QRTP. So they think about treatment facilities. They think about mental health. So much more than that.
Absolutely. I mean, when you describe it as a holistic system, it really is, because you're integrating mental health, you're integrating behavioral health, you're integrating life skills and support right. And in the medical side as well. So it's just really a neat thing that somebody can come to an IHH, and IHH is completely funded by Medicaid, right? So if I've got Medicaid or my child has Medicaid, I can get a support person, a case manager for myself to help me navigate through getting set up for services and coordinating services and getting to my appointments. I can do all of that for free. It doesn't cost me anything. It's like the best kept secret in Iowa, right? Because people don't
know. It really
is. It's like, oh, I can't, I would do that for my child, or I would do that for myself, but I can't afford it. When the truth is that these services are available for free if you've got Medicaid. And so I just, I think that it's so important to be spreading that message to anybody who will hear it. Because, you know, even if like, even if I don't have Medicaid, somebody I know does. One of my friends or one of my family members does. And when they come to me saying, oh my gosh, I'm having a trouble with, you know, even with like housing, or I'm having trouble with like keeping up with utilities, anything like that, that you guys can kind of help support them through that process and for free.
Right.
And I think that the peer support part too, it's something that I gotta be honest, like I'm in this field, but I never equate peer support with Four Oaks. You know, so there are a lot of peer support places, but Four Oaks doesn't always come up on my register, which is unfortunate because you guys are integrating peer support into all of these other services, right? There is that, that quality of like continuity of care with peer support. And peer support is an amazing, amazing service. I keynote at the Empowerment Conference every summer for the last 4 years. And oh my gosh, it's just the coolest group of people. And everybody's got an amazing story behind them, right? And a reason that they're doing it. So peer support is so purpose driven. It's just so passion driven.
It really
by the
is.
People who are doing peer support.
It really is. And it's a very underserved population in our communities. And to be quite honest, a lot of local IHHs don't want to dip their toes into peer support because it's a very hard population to engage in services and to serve. These kids are navigating adulthood with very, very low skill sets. They're afraid. What do we do when we're afraid? You isolate or you make risky decisions. And you make decisions that help you get through your day. A lot of times these kids will turn to drugs and alcohol use. They might be very, very vulnerable to being mistreated or taken advantage of in some way. Peer support is hard to do because a lot of times they don't reach out to you unless there's a crisis. Mm-hmm. And our peer support reach out to every single one of their clients multiple times a month just to make that connection. The more they feel connected, the less we feel they're going to isolate when they have a crisis. So peer support is a very unique thing that Four Oaks offers the communities that we serve. And we serve many, many counties in the state of Iowa. And it's one of the programs I'm most proud of.
Absolutely. Can you share with us what counties you guys are offering the peer support and what counties you're offering the IHH service so that anybody listening in Iowa, you know where you can find these services?
Well, I will just say that we have a staff of 20, and I will let you know kind of geographically where we're located. We have staff in Dubuque. And we have staff in Mason City. We also have a treatment campus in Mason City. So we serve all the surrounding counties to Cerro Gordo. We serve all the surrounding counties to Dubuque. We serve all the surrounding counties to Cedar Rapids, where our main campus is in Linn County. And we serve all the surrounding counties in Johnson County, where we have another campus in Iowa City. In each one of these campuses, we have IHH staff.
Wonderful. And so, you know, for us, it is great. Like you said, this partnership, because, you know, we've got an office in Cedar Rapids and Marion, and you guys are serving Linn County. We've got an office in Mason City and you guys are serving Cerro Gordo. So, it's just awesome to see these services, everybody working together, right, in this holistic way, to best serve needs. And it allows us as a counseling agency to say, we're going to focus on being mental health therapists. We're going to focus on being behavioral health counselors, and that there are other services that are available to be able to fill those gaps, right? Because as a client's therapist, so if I've got a 17-year-old client, it's not the best use of our session time, right, to be filling out FAFSA forms, right? It's so important for that person.
Yes.
But in the therapy setting, that's not what we're there to do.
Right.
And so being able to say, hey, IHH can help you with this. They can give you a peer support person who will meet with you, will go over it, will like read all of that super confusing FAFSA language. Like it's very overwhelming, right? To do all of, like, to file taxes. It's so overwhelming to do all of those adulting things. And so being able to as mental health therapists to be able to say, you know, I know that this is very important, but we're here in this session to talk about your mental health and to work on those goals. And then also knowing for us to know that our clients are being taken care of in that way as well. It's just so, so cool how it
can I have happen. So many stories, Julie, with therapists that have contacted us that have been working with 16, 17 year old kids. And that they weren't coming to their therapy appointments, and they involved IHH. We got those kiddos kind of engaged in our support services. And guess what? The therapy appointments started to happen more regularly for those children. So, I mean, just getting someone to come alongside those young adults, encouraging them, letting them know how important it is that they stay engaged in therapy is really something that IHH does really well in partnering with all their providers.
Absolutely. Tell us a little bit, just walk us through. So if I want to get involved in, if I want an IHH caseworker to help me get connected. So even if I want, like, if I'm like, ooh, I want BHIS for my child, or I want therapy for my child, but I also want, like, potentially medication management, I want to have maybe apply for the waiver, right? And I don't really know where to start. IHH right. is a great place to start. So how does somebody, what, first of all, how do they find you? And then also, what can they expect when they make contact for the first time?
Absolutely. So they can call us at 319-784-2250. That line is answered 24/7. And they call us, they say that we are interested in some community-based supports. I will get that referral sent directly to me, and I will call that individual. I will explain to the person calling me, whether it's an adult, or let's just, for this example, say it's a parent. So the parent, I will call the parent, kind of get a little bit background. They might have a kiddo that's struggling at home and school. The kiddo could be anywhere from 3 years old to 18. And they are needing some, they need therapy. They need BHIS. They need medication management. They need help with the school, that they might want to get a child on an IEP for additional academic support or behavioral support. And I kind of get some information regarding that. If the child is already seeing a therapist, I'll get a release and reach out to that therapist right away to get some clinical information about the child. I will let the parent know that IHH is voluntary and it is free if your child's on Medicaid. You can disenroll at any time. We don't come to your home unless we're invited. We do like to see the family in their home environment, however, because it does help us coordinate care in the most holistic way we can. We like to know the family dynamic. We like to see the family interact with one another. We also like to sit and observe the behavior of the child. We might want to know what triggers the child, what the child does when he's escalated. What does the family do when the child's escalated? Do we need a safety plan here? Is the child put himself at risk or herself at risk when they're escalated? That could be self-harm. It could be elopement. It could be kicking, pinching, biting, shouting. So we really like to be we'd like to get to know the family as best we can, but it all starts with asking those simple questions. What is your biggest concern? What do you feel you need the most right now? Is it therapy? Is it med management? Well, if it's one of those things, let's make a referral. Do you need to get this child on the child mental health waiver wait list? We do that. The wait list can be very long, and long, I mean months. It can be 18 months or more waiting for a slot to open on the child mental health waiver. Getting these children plugged in to those types of services, state-funded services, is so important when they're young. Getting them engaged in the school system and with behavioral and academic supports when they're young is so important. We think that we have this large window of opportunity, and especially with parents who reach out to us who are in crisis, we respond within one business day to those referrals because, as I said earlier, when families are in crisis, oftentimes they isolate. So that window that they are accessible, that they are actually putting themselves in a vulnerable position where that conversation might be welcome to them, you really have to strike fast so that we can get them engaged in services, or else they may retreat back to old habits and the cycle continues. We really want to break that cycle by putting them in touch with services.
Absolutely. It can be such a daunting process to say, I don't even know what's available. Like the only reason I know what child mental health waiver is because I was a BHIS counselor and they said, hey, you're going to start doing waiver services. And I said, okay, you know, and that was like 10 years ago, 12 years ago. And so, you know, that was the only way that I knew what that was. And so what I love about IHH and the case management there is that there are services available that people have never heard of. And so, yeah, you might call in and say, I want medication management because that's what your experience is. That's what other people in your life have done. But once you talk to your case manager, you might find out that, oh, there are these other services that might even fit your situation better than what you came in for. Mm-hmm. And I love that. I love that you're building relationships with people, even when it's not a crisis, because we talk about that in terms of therapy all the time, that gosh, when I'm in a crisis, I don't want to talk to anybody new. I don't want to meet anybody new when I'm in a crisis. Like, I don't want to do it. But if it's somebody that I have a relationship with that I talk to once a week or once a month already, then when I do have those crisis situations come up, I'm already talking to somebody that I trust, and I'm not trying to build trust during a crisis situation, which is like the hardest time to build trust.
It really is. I often tell families all the time, the best time to join IHH is when your family is stable.
Yeah.
Because then we can get those interventions in place and create that stability long-term. IHH is not meant to be a lifetime program. We want to get families back to being self-sufficient, accessing these services on their own, so that they can work towards independence. That is our goal. Our goal and our mission of the enterprise is to ensure that children become successful adults. And that's we really, every single one of my staff really focuses on that mission daily in their work.
Absolutely. I love that. I love the empowerment of that, because I think that the term caseworker gets such a bad rap, right? Like, are you a DHS caseworker?
Yes,
like, are you here to evaluate if my house is clean enough? Like, are you know, like, what does caseworker mean? And it does get such a bad rap. So I love that you're out there sharing what that really means. And what it means is I will listen to the situation that family is in, and then empower that family to decide what services of the available services are going to be most helpful to them, so that they can have their own systems in place. So yeah, I love that.
You know, the state has determined that this is adults and children who live in communities who are on Title 19 and who have a mental health diagnosis. The state has really determined, with their huge investment in local IHHs, that local support is the best support for these families. Calling an 800 number and getting someone in Des Moines when you live in Cedar Rapids and you're having a mental health crisis is not how you get your communities to function the best way. So having localized support and partnering with agencies is really the best way that communities can get their arms wrapped around their most vulnerable citizens.
Absolutely. I mean, it's such a different conversation for somebody at like a call center in Des Moines, because all of the MCOs, they have their case managers, right? And they do a lot of really good work. They do refer for therapy, but it is different. The conversation of, well, let me look up your zip code and let me give you some names and phone numbers, versus here's an agency that a lot of my other, you know, families that I work with have worked with. This is how it works. These are some of the providers there that I really recommend. It's that warm handoff and that ability to say, yeah, this is one that, like, I know where the building is, right? All of that stuff is so important. And to be able to also just understand what's going on in that community. So like Linn County, for example, right? All of Linn County's been through a lot this past year with derecho and with flooding, and just it's been a really difficult year for Linn County. And somebody who lives in Story County or Cerro Gordo isn't going to have that same understanding, right? Of what's going on. Because if you live in Linn County, you went through it as well. So it just is very different doing it localized. I think that's such an important distinction and an important way that you guys really do serve those families in a different way. Yeah. So they can call in. I also love that when somebody calls in, so if I call that number for myself or my child, you're the person I'm going to talk, not when I call in, but you're the person who's going to follow up with me.
Oftentimes I am the one who follows up. I really like it. It helps me as the director to call the family, to get to know them so I can properly assign them to staff. I don't like to just push referrals out to my staff. Every single one of my staff have a very high skill set, but they also have these expertises in certain areas. And I really like to have those referrals funnel towards me so I can give those families the best match in the skill sets that my staff have.
I love that. It's a very strength-based approach being able to match with strengths and match needs that are specific to that family. I think that's great. And I love that, you know, we can do an interview like this. Somebody can see this video and it takes a little bit of that scariness out of calling in, right? Because when I call an 800 number, I don't know who's going to be on the other line. If I'm going through something very, very personal in my family, the idea of sharing that story with a stranger is really anxiety producing. I don't care who you are. Like, it's hard to share those things with a stranger. Being able to see your face, to hear how much you care about the families that you work with is so important, so helpful, because somebody can know, okay, that's the person that I'm going to share this information with, right? And she's not scary and she's not going to judge me.
Not at all. In fact, I think that first step takes a lot of courage and a lot of bravery. I always make sure that families know that it takes a lot of courage to pick up the phone and to recognize that what is going on in your life is beyond your control. And beyond your control could only be 3 feet tall. You know, that this, you have a child who came to you without a playbook, without any directions. And here you have this child who has a mental health diagnosis, and admitting as a parent that this is beyond what you can do, you need help, can be very heartbreaking to a parent. And it's nothing that they haven't done. That's no mistake that they've made. It's, you just have to make sure that you know that you're coming to a very safe place to ask for help. And there isn't going to be any judgment at all. We're going to come alongside you in any way that makes you the most comfortable. And that's how we're going to case manage this for you. And if we make a referral to a provider and you say, nope, I'm not going to do that, it really doesn't matter. We really feel like you might need this service, but if you're not comfortable doing it, let's go a different direction then. So the last thing we want to do is engage services, coordinate care in services the family won't access because there's some barrier. We're going to make sure that the family has a lot of input and it involves family buy-in. And if you can get the family the buy-in, that's only going to help the child.
Absolutely. I love that you take into such high consideration the barriers to engaging in services, because there are so many barriers, and some of them are, you know, you guys are able to help with, and some of them are just personal decision or personal life experiences that put up a barrier there, and that's okay. And I love that you guys are respectful of that, because it's not always the right time for that, right? Like maybe somebody starts with peer support because they need to be able to kind of have an introduction into working with somebody or letting somebody into their lives and telling somebody about what's going on and asking for help. Right. So I really, really like that, you know, help that is provided against somebody's will really isn't help. Right. So that's the only
Not
way
at all.
That we can actually be helpful is for people who are wanting that help and in a place to be able to receive it. And that I love that you're saying, just normalizing the experience of as a parent. I mean, gosh, I've got a 4-year-old and she is outside of my control, man. Yeah. I want to believe that I can protect her from things and I can teach her the ways of the world. And she just proves me every day. Like, nope, you're not, I'm 4. And you know, they're out of our control, and the things that they go through are out of our control. I can't make her have friends at preschool. I can't make her right. And so I can't control all of those things, but I know that if my daughter, so when my daughter was 2, she fell outside and she scraped her nose. And okay, she's half Korean, so her nose is like tiny already. Right. And so she scraped it all the way down here. And I felt like the worst mom in the world. I was like, oh my gosh, my kid has this giant thing, right? Anywhere we go. And so she had like a little Band-Aid over her nose and it was the cutest thing, but also it was the saddest thing. And so the thing is that like, I still took her to the doctor, right? Because I was like, okay, I don't know if this thing is like going to be infected or whatever. So I took her in. But that was hard as a parent, right? Because like, not because the doctor was making it hard, right? Not because I shouldn't bring her in. I should bring her in just to get it checked out. But at the same time, like I had my own guilt with it. Like I felt like, oh, I should have been watching her better. I should have been holding her hand at that moment, right? Like how could I let her fall down and scrape up her nose, right? As a mom. And so I can so relate with when it comes to mental health services, like I felt like that with medical services, right? Medical stuff. And so when it comes to mental health stuff, I think there's even more of this idea that as parents, we can control that. Or as parents, we can protect them from that. And the truth is that we can't, you know, and I work with mental health providers, mental health therapists, and they can't with their kids, right? Because there are kids. And so I love that you guys normalize that it is not something that we have control over. If our child has behavioral concerns, or if our child has mental health concerns that present in behaviors, there is kind of this societal idea that like, oh, that's a reflection of the parents. And it's just not true. I mean, we see parents all the time doing everything right. And part of doing everything right is getting that support, being able to say, okay, I don't have control over this situation, but I'm going to take her to the doctor, even though I feel, you know, my own guilt about her falling down. I'm still going to take her to the doctor. And I think the same thing is true. There's that hurdle of getting over, you know, thinking of our kids as a reflection of ourselves, which is even more difficult, I think, when your kid is like your mini me. Like my kid looks exactly like me. She acts exactly. It's like arguing with myself, right? But then being able to say like that isn't something that I have control of. I need an outside support for a lot of those things. Yeah. So just normalizing that, I think, is so helpful, because it can feel so isolating as a parent. And then, you know, the kiddos that you work with that are young adults, what an isolating time in general. We think about, you know, idealist best case scenario, it's still an isolating time. So being 18, leaving your family, potentially going to a different city or state, and changing, leaving your school, stuff like that, is challenging anyway. And then if you don't have support people or role models in your life to be able to help you navigate all of these new things going on, what a difficult time in general. So I'm just so excited that you guys help those young people as well. Cool. So we have your quote here. So your favorite quote, Sue, is look for helpers. You will always find people who are helping. And this is a Mr. Rogers quote. I love this quote as well. But tell us what this means to you in terms of your role.
I think it's something that I have thought about as a young child who grew up watching Mr. Rogers, and that we all have moments in our life that we're afraid and that we don't know what to do, or we're seeing something that we cannot process well. And I think that it's a life message for anyone of any age, that if you see something that you're frightened, that frightens you, or that you're having a hard time processing, look for the person who is helping. The person who is helping really defines the situation. And I myself have always been drawn to be a helper. And that's why I'm in this profession. And I have always taken great pride in being a helper. I think I raised children who are helpers. And I think that I have a staff full of people who are helpers. Helpers are someone who, despite their own fears, will jump in to assist. They are cool, calm contributors to our communities, and they come in all shapes and sizes. So I think that quote is important to me, because a helper may not fit the mold that you think they should look like or be like, but just look towards their actions, because that's what identifies a helper.
Absolutely. I love that. There's so much going on in our world that we can't control, but we get to choose. When something happens that overwhelms us, we get to choose what we focus on, and we get to choose to look for the helpers. And we also choose to get to be the helpers in any situation. So I love that quote. I love how you integrate that into your own work at IHH, and then also the team that you have built around you as well.
You know, we are just here to help. That's all we're here to do. Everyone who works for IHH comes from a social service background. Our case managers all have degrees, and they have chosen to work with families and adults who are vulnerable, who are struggling with mental health. We have different tiers of support. And I know we spoke a lot about transitional care and in this podcast. I think, again, I will state again, it's a very underserved part of our communities. And we have different tiers of support for those transitional age kids. They may age out of treatment and try to go to their own apartment, and they have peer support, and all of a sudden they 6 months later decide, I can't do this on my own. I don't know how to live. I don't know how to budget, grocery shop. I don't know how to manage my medications. I'm not getting to my appointments. Okay, so maybe they need to be tiered up to habilitation services now, where our case manager would again start making referrals to HAB homes, where they could have supportive community living. Maybe that's what they need to be successful, but it took this life experience for them to realize they needed this additional tier of support. So again, look to the helpers. We're only here to help.
I love that, because it takes away the pressure to start at the right service, right? Yeah. So it's like, I could be offered the habilitation setting, right? But maybe I'm like, no, I don't want that. I don't need that, right? I'm going to start with this other support. And then through the process of doing that, then maybe I can see like, oh, well, maybe this other one might be useful to me, right? Mm-hmm. But if I don't try the peer support, I'm never going to know that. I'm never going to have the experience that tells me that, yeah, maybe this other service would also be useful to me. So I love that people can start with whatever service they start with. As long as they're kind of starting the ball rolling, then yeah, you eliminate out services that don't help you. And you would never know that you didn't like that service if you didn't try it. And mm-hmm. you can also open the door to other services that, that are going to be really helpful and a good fit for you or your family. So I love that, that people can start anywhere.
Yeah. I mean, a lot of kids might start at in habilitation homes where they're getting supportive community living. Mm-hmm. 2 years later, they've learned the skills through dayhab, through therapy, through supportive community living. And all of a sudden, you know what? They're ready to try living on their own in their own apartment and still getting SCL services. So they still would have an SCL person that would be checking in on them every couple times a week, and depending what tier they're at. And, you know, that's what we want. We want these individuals to eventually be productive community members. And so we just come alongside them and help them do that.
My daughter last year got a, for her birthday, she got a like transforming scooter. So it's a scooter with training wheels on it. You can take the training wheels off when she gets a little older, and then it's got a scooter handle. You take the scooter handle off and it becomes a skateboard, right? When she next year. And this is kind of what's coming to mind with these integrated services is just that you can mix and match as you grow and the services grow with you. So as you make progress, those services grow with you. And I think that's so great for customization. Okay. So if you could give one suggestion to somebody on the fence about starting counseling or just about starting in with help and support in general, what suggestion might you give that person?
I would suggest to them that they get out of their own way. Be brave. Just pick up the phone. I guarantee that you're going to find someone on the other end of the line that just wants to help.
I love that. Courage, just being brave. And, you know, and courage isn't the absence of fear. Like, of course, it's anxiety producing, but it's doing it anyway, it's doing it through the fear that means that we're being courageous and brave. So I love that. Absolutely. Be brave.
There's one thing I've always told my families. When I first came to Four Oaks, I was doing a lot of case management for children on the child mental health waiver. And through learning more and more about mental health, one of the things that I read once that really stuck with me is know who you are. So I often would tell a child that, know who you are. You are a child with anxiety. You're a child with on the autism spectrum. You might be a child that is aggressive. You know, knowing who you are, whether you're a child or parent of a child or whether you're an adult, knowing who that individual is will drive your actions. So picking up the phone and calling Hardin Solutions to get a therapy referral or calling IHH because you need coordination of care, that first step is just to know that you need help. Knowing that a situation is beyond your control, beyond what your skill set is, and just know who you are.
That's wonderful suggestions. I love that. And accepting. It's about acceptance, mm-hmm. accepting who we are right this moment. It doesn't mean that's who we're going to be forever, but at this moment, this is who I am. And having the acceptance of that is just so key. So I love that. Okay. So can you tell us that phone number again, if somebody wants to call in? And that's a 24-hour line, which is amazing.
24-hour line. It's staffed by IHH. Awesome. And it's 319-784-2250.
Perfect. So if you are in Cerro Gordo County, if you are out by Dubuque, if you are in Linn County or Iowa City, Johnson County, definitely give Sue a call because she very, very clearly wants to help you. Her team wants to help you in any way that they can. So awesome.
I am Sue Brooks and I need a counselor.
Awesome. Me too. So does Krista. We all do. Awesome. If you are in Iowa, in Waterloo, Grundy Center, Cedar Rapids, Marion, Davenport, Mason City, Ames, Jefferson, Marshalltown, Newton, Ankeny, Iowa Falls, give us a call. Heart and Solutions, if you want to do in-home behavioral health counseling or therapy, you can call us at 800-531-4236. You can do phone counseling so that you don't have to put on makeup or put on normal pants. Awesome. Do phone counseling. That's great. Or you can meet with us in person, or we can do those in-home behavioral health sessions as well.
And like Julie mentioned at the beginning, we post every Sunday night at 5 p.m. Central Time. So save up your laundry for the week. Do your laundry with us while you listen to our new episode of our podcast. And we can help prepare you to call a counselor that week as well.
Absolutely. So we really, really thank you, Sue, for being here on the line with us today. I think it's been so informative and just really, really helpful information. If you're listening to this podcast and you've got questions for Sue, or you've got questions about counseling in general, let us know. You can send confidential messages on Facebook Messenger at You Need a Counselor Podcast. You can send DMs on You Need a Counselor Podcast on Instagram. And you can give us a call at Heart and Solutions as well. We would love to have Sue back on another interview and another episode to do some follow-up. And if you've got questions that you would love to have answered on the podcast by Sue, definitely let us know, because we'll save those for the next time that Sue is here on the line.
All right. So I'm Krista Brown.
And I'm Julie Johnson. And we need a counselor.
And so do you.
Bye.
Bye.